it's very hard to talk about what I want to talk about today without any logic. So we're going to have to actually introduce a little bit of logical terminology. We've been using it to some extent, and sometimes I think the best way to actually be introduced to logic as a philosopher is really just to see it appear and start picking it up, as it were, without a formal introduction. I remember telling my advisor as an undergraduate that I was interested in logic and thought I should take a course in logic. And he said, don't do it. Complete waste of time. Either you can think or you can't. If you can already think, you don't need logic. And if you can't think, logic isn't going to help you. However, it seems to me that actually logic can help you a lot in thinking about certain philosophical issues. And so today we're going to have to actually encounter a little bit of logic, because Quine introduces in this paper that we're going to be discussing today his famous thought that to be is to be a value of a variable. And at first glance, that sounds absurd, right? And so you have to think, well, what does he mean to be a value of a variable? What is a variable, anyway? And how does it function in a logical system? And so we're going to be led very quickly from questions about metaphysics to questions about logic. And there's no avoiding that, in a sense. So I'm not going to do it in a very formal way, in the way that I would do it if I were introducing logic as logic. But nevertheless, we're going to have to actually confront that at certain points. So, this paper itself, as I found out over the weekend, is really hard to track down. It was slated to appear in Volume 9 of Erkenntnis, a journal of unified science, in 1939. Due to the outbreak of World War II, they moved the operations of the journal to Holland, and then the Nazis invaded Holland, and so this journal issue never appeared. Hence, when I said, well, yes, I forgot to scan it in from the book, and it's not in quintessence, but hey, no problem. I'm sure I can find a copy online. It turned out to be impossible to do that because, well, it never appeared. So even though it became a famous paper in this formulation that to be is to be a value of a variable, it became a very famous idea. It turns out that the paper in which it was actually articulated was not published until 1966, when this collection of essays came out. It was circulated more informally before that. So let's start by taking a look at what Quine says here. As you can see, this is a well-loved book. The cover came off years ago, but I won't defile it with tape. So tape back on. So I just keep it carefully in place. Anyway, what does it mean to ask, for example, whether there is such an entity as roundness? Well, we've got here thrown out a major ontological, a major metaphysical question from the medieval era, at least, whether we ought to recognize as components of the world things like roundness. Well, we can even go back before the medieval era to Plato and think, aha, what is the ontological status of the forms? Do the forms have some separate existence apart from the objects that might exemplify them or might participate in them? So we can ask about roundness. When we think about the ultimate constituents of the world, what do we do with roundness? Is that one of the things that, to use Russell's phrase, would have to count as part of the furniture of the world? Well, before we go into the question in some detail and what Quine would have to say about it, let's think about that question all by itself. First glance, just intuitively, if I ask you, what's in this room, would you say, among the various things you might say, roundness?
No.
Okay, no. Quine agrees. It's like, yeah, I would start saying, well, it's actually puzzling. There are two trash cans by the door. I guess they must think people in this room generate a lot of garbage. There are a certain number of desks. There are people. There are blackboards. There's a computer, et cetera, et cetera. There's a clock. But I wouldn't stop to say, oh, yeah, right. I mean, also the rectangularity of the blackboard and the roundness of the clock. And that means rectangularity, roundness. And gosh, those lines are pretty straight. Straightness. And curvedness, and blah, blah, blah. I wouldn't start listing all those abstract things, right? Now, why not? Why would I stop at talking about the clock and the blackboard and not talk about rectangularity or roundness?
Because they're qualities that physical objects have.
Ah, all right, there's a good Aristotelian answer. They're qualities that physical objects have. So you might think, well, wait a minute. Yes, we do talk about qualities and quantities and relations and actions and affections and states and positions and all the other things in Aristotle's categories. But in the end, it all depends on substance, right? The things there are, in Aristotle's way of thinking about the world, really are the substances. And then, yeah, so it's things like the clock. And then the clock does have roundness, if we want to put it in that sort of language. But on the other hand, it's the clock that really exists here, and the qualities, the relations, and so on, all of that, you might think have, if they have any sort of existence at all, it's highly derivative. So remember, we drew a distinction between metaphysics and ontology. And ontology, we said, was the study of what there is. Really, we should perhaps say, well, what there, gosh, really is, ultimately is. And then we said metaphysics includes that, but metaphysics is much broader. Now, why is that true? What does metaphysics include that ontology doesn't include?
How you perceive what really is?
Ah, how you perceive what really is. So you might think the connection between mind and world is something that ought to be included here, not, in other words, just what the world ultimately consists of, but also something about how our minds relate to it. What else might be included under metaphysics?
Epistemology?
Well, usually epistemology is thought to be a separate topic, so that there's one question of what the world is like, and so on, and then another, how we know that. So, for example, if you say, well, I mean perception in the sense of how it is that we relate to the world, that is a very broad question. It has epistemological aspects as well as metaphysical aspects. Sometimes those get deeply intertwined. And in fact, there are philosophers who think there isn't a sharp distinction to be drawn between metaphysics and epistemology. So if you're inclined toward idealism or any variety of anti-realism, you're going to think, well, yeah, wait a minute, it's all tied up together. I can't sort of have some radically non-epistemic way of thinking about the way the world is, in which case it looks like epistemology and metaphysics fuse into this one big unit. But if we don't want to assume that from the start, we might say, well, the question of how I know the world is one thing, but then the question of what the world is like is another. That's going to include, in a broad sense, this question of the connection between mind and world, but might not include specifics about, well, for example, how exactly we know universal statements or something like that. What else might be included in a metaphysical picture that wouldn't be a matter of just counting the ultimate furniture of the universe? Yeah?
The relations between the pieces of furniture.
Yeah, the relations between the pieces of furniture. Exactly. So you might say it's a question of identifying the structure of the world, of the things that ontology identifies, and not just those things and how they relate to one another, but also how various things that aren't ultimate constituents are structured in terms of those. So you might think there's a question of, actually, I think we drew a fuzzy picture where, in a sense, ontology was a question of identifying these ultimate constituents, but then those things are structured into all sorts of complexes, as Russell might put it, and then we can talk about how those complexes relate to one another and to the ultimate simples and so forth. So there are all these relations, there are all these constructions, or if you want to think of it this way, complexes and simples. Now, in a sense, I can't tell you what I'm looking for here without committing to some particular metaphysical theory, right? Because the moment I say complexes and simples, I'm now sort of invoking some kind of atomistic picture of the world. And if I talk about constructions, I'm already assuming these relations have a certain kind of character and so forth. So I'm putting things here that we've already identified as going on in analytic philosophy, but actually, if you want to think much more broadly about this, you should realize I'm just talking here about examples of the kind of relation you might have in mind. Presumably you're going to have a different way of thinking about those relationships if you've got another metaphysical picture. Are there other things that fit into metaphysics?
Questions about things like God that might be outside of the world as we usually think of it.
Ooh, okay, so yeah, we think about various objects in the world, but then there are some that have a special status. So you might think, look, It's one thing to talk about, let's say, atoms, physical atoms, or minds, or something like that. It's quite another to actually talk about God, which seems to be not just one more object among others in the world, right? But to have some special status. And the same thing you might think is true of personal identity. Because after all, if you're thinking, wait a minute, I also want to know as part of metaphysics, who am I? And what kind of thing am I? And that's not just saying I'm an ultimate constituent, or maybe I'm not. Gosh, there's an ontological worry. What if you add up all the things in the world and I'm not among them? Ooh. Well, don't worry, you might say. There's a separate metaphysical question. Just what kind of thing am I? Who am I? What am I? And so we might think that the nature of God, and for that matter, of me, personal identity, becomes a crucial thing to think about here. I care not only about the tables and chairs of the world, the atoms and electrons and fields and so on, but I also care about me, and I care about whether or not there's a God. Good. This is a start to thinking about metaphysics as something that includes a lot of stuff. And as we see here, well, as we will see, Quine's essay starts with ontology. He really acts as if he's just dealing with this ontological question of what the ultimate constituents of the world are. Well, even more simply, just what it is to say that something is. But then, actually, he does draw the distinction between these ultimate constituents and other things. And so we're going to have to think about the structuring as well as just the sort of counting. Now, so we've said, okay, for example, roundness. Is there such an entity? He says, note that we can use the word roundness without acknowledging any such entity as roundness. We can maintain that the word is syncategrammatic. So, there's a distinction that is, well, where does it go back to? It's found in, he mentions, well, actually he doesn't mention, a lot of people mention William of Ockham in this connection. It goes back at least to Peter of Spain. And I'm not sure that Peter of Spain is the one in the 13th century actually introduces this term for the first time. But there's a distinction from medieval logic between categorematic terms and syncategrammatic terms. Now, Quine doesn't actually explain it. He just assumes you know this already, which is kind of an amazing thing, because, like, who knows this? Okay. yeah, I'm the sort of person who just to brush up on my Latin reads Peter of Spain in Latin because it's fun. Okay? But I assume that I'm very, very weird for doing that. So there aren't very many people who would just know what these terms mean offhand. But the idea in medieval logic is this. A syncategrammatic term is one that doesn't really stand for anything. A categrammatic term does, okay? So to just put it very broadly, this stands for something. And often the medievals will say something definite. They're worried about problems of vagueness and things like, well, phrases like a man or whatever. And a syncategrammatic term is not like that. It doesn't stand for anything. So if we think about items in language that we think of typically as categrammatic, as standing for something, what would those include from a grammatical point of view? What do we take in language to be standing for something?
A noun.
A noun, typically, yeah, exactly. So, among those, for example, are proper names. But then there might be other kinds of nouns, maybe common nouns. Or maybe noun phrases, determiner phrases. The details of that are going to vary with our linguistic theory. But now, syncategrammatic terms, well, they don't stand for anything. So what are some of the things in language we would think typically don't stand for anything?
Adjectives?
Yeah, good. So we might think, adjectives are like that. If I say that thing is round, the clock is round, do I think that round names some entity?
Adverbs.
Good, adverbs. He did it quickly. quickly we don't think stands for some object in the world. Or I say, surprisingly, blah, 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 blah. You don't sort of think, oh, surprisingly, yeah, there's that thing again. He keeps talking about that interesting object, surprisingly. No, there's no such thing that it's standing for. And you might think, oh, not once you get going, there are lots of these, right? I mean, what other parts of speech don't stand for anything?
Prepositions.
Prepositions, yeah. A preposition doesn't stand for anything. Queen of England. You might say, oh, well, actually, there are three objects there. The Queen, England, and of. But that seems silly somehow. Yeah.
Numbers?
Numbers. Ah, yeah, numbers. Now, that's an interesting one, because it looks as if when we say 1 plus 1 is 2, those look like proper names of things, right? On the other hand, we can talk about five birds on the wire, for example, and there, five just seems to be an adjective. And so numbers are weird because sometimes they act as proper names and sometimes they act as adjectives. And we're going to have to say something about how that sort of thing is possible. But yes, at least in the adjective version, it seems like it's odd to think of, oh, yeah, what was on the wire? There were these birds and also the number five. Yeah.
Yeah, I've, on road trips before, I've tried, just like when I've been bored as hell, I've tried to think of things like numbers that we can't live without or that we need to explain the world with, but that you can't point to physically. What are other things like that are like in that category? I could never think of anything.
All right, that's a great question. Because in the end, this jumps us ahead a little bit, but good. Quine is going to say, look, I don't actually care very much what is required to make sense of your speech or my speech, because he's convinced that a lot of what we say is more or less nonsense. And so the real question is going to be, what is required for the language of science? And so you might say, yeah, look, this is all fine to talk about things in ordinary speech, parts of speech, and so on, but really, in the end, we're going to care about what science requires. And if you and I find it a little bit difficult to talk about the objects we're passing by on the road trip, or, you know, our own thoughts and feelings, well, who cares? In the end, we care about science, Quine says, and what science requires. So one way of looking at this is to say, you and I in our common speech, we're using language for all sorts of purposes that aren't just describing the world. But the science, the job of science, is really to focus on that question alone, to think what is required to describe the world. And so if I'm thinking about these questions of ontology, what there really is, or metaphysics, about the structure of the world, ultimately, I care more about science than I care about ordinary language. You might divide the philosophers we've been talking about, in fact, into three categories, depending upon their view of this. What are we really doing philosophy about? In a sense, all of these early analytic philosophers think that language is key, and that it's not just that language is a useful tool in thinking about philosophical questions, but in a sense, philosophical questions are questions of language. But there are three types. And so you might say, we've got some of these people that we could call ideal language philosophers. Those are people like Frege, Russell, Wittgenstein.
What does ideal mean in this?
Good question. What do I mean? Ideal? Well, yeah. What's special about the language of the Tractatus, for example? Or special about Russell's way of thinking about definite descriptions? He thinks it's more revealing than ordinary speech. But how so? Ideal in what respect?
So it's ambiguous.
Good. It's not ambiguous. So that's one thing. It's got this, clarity to it. And so the clarity of the structure of this language is important. Is there something else? Yeah.
Closer to being true or accurately describing.
Yeah, closer to accurately describing the world. So it's not only got this clear structure, but the underlying thought is it really reveals the underlying structure of the world. And so it serves almost as a mirror of the world. In fact, sometimes these philosophers seem to think the ideal language would really just be a mirror of reality. And it leads you into funny questions. Borges has a story where he's talking about somebody who is deciding they need a really perfectly adequate map of the world. And they realized for it to be perfectly adequate, it would just have to be the world. Because it would have to stand in one-to-one correspondence with all the things in the world. And if it was really drawn to scale, it would just be the world. And so in a certain sense, that's kind of a vision of what this ideal language would be like. Ideal in being clear as opposed to ambiguous or vague, and also in respect to reflecting the underlying structures. Then we're going to see some philosophers who are, you might call them ordinary language philosophers, who think that, no, it's a cheat to sort of introduce such an ideal language. Partly it distorts what our ordinary speech is like, and partly too, how can we say this is a language that mirrors the structure of the world unless we already know what the structure of the world is? So this can't be taken as a tool for revealing the structure of the world if a criterion of its being ideal is that it does reveal the structure. We must then already know the structure. So these people think, no, start with English or French or German or Chinese or some other natural language and think about metaphysics and so on in terms of that. So who are some examples of this? Well, we've already seen one, I think, Ryle. Dale Austin is a famous example. P.F. Strawson. Paul Grice. Let's see. Oh, and of course, the later Wittgenstein. Okay, but in between, you might say, there are these scientific language philosophers. And they're the people we're studying right now. Or for the most part, have been. We took a detour into Ryle. And so here I have in mind the Vienna Circle and the Berlin Circle. So figures like Carnap, Hempel, Schlick, Neurath, and so on. And Quine is one of those. Quine, in fact, went to Vienna and hung out with the Vienna Circle for a while in the 1930s. And studied in particular with Carnap, and so somebody who was very much influenced by this. Interestingly, Quine actually studied, got his degree at Harvard, under people who were primarily pragmatists. And so throughout his writings, as we'll see, there's this conflict going on between logical empiricism and pragmatism. His teachers at Harvard were all pragmatists, but the guys he was hanging out with in Vienna were all logical empiricists, and so you see in his work an attempt to synthesize these. Actually, one of our students visited Harvard and found Quine in his office and said, so throughout your work, there are these two warring tendencies, the logical empiricism and the pragmatism. Suppose in the end you had to put your chips on one or the other. So suppose in the end, it was like, I don't know, he didn't use this phrase with Quine, and Quine wouldn't have liked it. But it's sort of like, you die and you're there at the gates of heaven. And St. Peter says, so in Quine, you know, you're kind of mixing these two strands together. In the end, what is it? Is it logical empiricism or is it pragmatism? Whether you get in depends on your answer. and interestingly, Quine said, oh, logical empiricism. So we're going to see him infusing more and more pragmatist themes into logical empiricism, but in the end, he would place himself clearly there. Okay, so anyway, the language of science is what he really cares about. Now let me come back to your question, which is a key question. In a sense, yeah, it's all fine to think about this in English, but in the end, what does the language of science look like? What do we need for science? What does the language of science look like? It doesn't really have adverbs in it, for example, does it? I mean, we can talk about the particle moving more swiftly, but in the end, we don't really use adverbs in the language of science. We introduce a term for that, acceleration. And so, what do we use in science? Yeah.
I was just going to say, we use symbols to represent things we can't necessarily see or perceive. But
good. For one thing, this is highly symbolic, right? So we're going to have to understand what's going on in a symbolic language, like the language of science, like the language of mathematics or of logic, as opposed to thinking about things primarily in English. So although Quine starts this as essay, thinking about English and categogrammatic and syncategogrammatic terms, in fact, that's not where the real test lies, where the rubber meets the road. That's in the symbolic languages of science. And so in that symbolism, I mean, just think about a few simple scientific laws, like forces, mass times acceleration. What's going on there? Well, we've got identity statements. We've got mathematical quantities. So there's a huge amount of math. We do a lot of identification. of what exactly? What is force? These aren't proper names, right? What are they?
It depends on what you're talking about.
It depends on what we're talking about, yeah. And so, well, actually, let's think about mass, because maybe it's simpler. Like right now, I have a certain mass, right? But that mass changes. Actually, ever since Thanksgiving, it's been changing quite a bit in the wrong direction. You might notice that I'm wearing like the same three pairs of pants all the time. It's because they're the only ones that fit me at the moment. So, yeah. Anyway, by the end of term, I promise I will start losing mass and get better at this. But anyway, yeah, we talk about an object having a mass and a time, right? And so really, this is something like a function. It's the mass of Dan Bonavac at time t. And I might say, oh, yes, I've been gaining weight. In other words, this function has been increasing over time. I'm hoping to get it to decrease. And so that's something you might think is, well, okay, a function. So there are all sorts of things that are going to be expressible as functions. And indeed, acceleration is like that, too. I may be accelerating at a time, right? Or decelerating at a time, or maintaining a constant velocity at a time. So this, too, looks like it's an object at a time. And so presumably force is going to be, the force applies to an object at a given time. So that's probably a function of objects and times. But then there are all sorts of other things that are actually, even this is way too simple, right? Because actually if you think about velocity, for example, a physicist will often write velocity not just as a V, but as a vector. And why? Because the velocity is not just a question of moving at a certain rate, but in a certain direction. And so if we think, wait a minute, if that's true, then acceleration should also be understood as that, and the same with force, those have a direction. Then we're going to need vectors there as well as just positions and so forth. So what this is a function of is actually going to be fairly complicated, and if you start thinking, oh yes, we're going to need vectors and derivatives and integrals and functions and all of this kind of stuff, you realize there's quite a lot of mathematics we're going to need here. Now exactly how much depends on our physical theory, and that's a complicated question, but at the very least, we're going to need a substantial part of mathematics. What else will we need? We are going to have some idea. Well, maybe the key is to just jump straight to this. We're going to need things like variables, like an object, x, like a time, t, maybe a position, p, and so forth. We're going to need variables that stand for the basic things that our language is going to be talking about. So far, we've been taking physics as an example, and physics is often taken as the most basic science, but we could also start thinking, well, what about chemistry? Is it going to require additional things? Maybe we're going to need terms for elements in physics and so forth, or in chemistry and so on. So it turns out to be crucial to think, well, what does this language of science really require? Now, let's get back to the essay. I feel like I keep pulling this Philip Reeve thing. We've only gotten through two sentences. But let's see if we can do a little better. Okay. So he says, really, in the end, if we go back to this distinction between the categrammatic and the syncategrammatic, one way of thinking about it is that these categrammatic expressions are names of something. These are not names of anything. Okay? So he says, we can ask an important question. Is this the name of something? To ask whether there's such an entity as roundness is thus not to ask the question of the meaningfulness of roundness. It amounts rather to asking whether the word is a name or a syncategrammatic expression. Well, he says, and this is a crucial point, ontological questions can be transformed in this superficial way into linguistic questions regarding the boundary between names and syncategrammatic expressions. So we can think, aha, we can take an ontological question, what is there? And we can say, well, that's really a way of saying, how do I draw that line? These are going to be names of things, and so these are going to stand for something, and so that something, that'll be something I recognize in my ontology. It's something that is. Whereas here, these things don't stand for anything, so I don't have to worry about them from an ontological point of view. And so I can say, well, what is there really? That's a way of saying, which expressions in my language are categorematic? Which expressions in my language stand for something? So notice what's happened. Ontology just gets transformed into a question about language. I go from the question, what is there, to the question of what in my language stands for stuff. Now, where does the boundary fall? Well, he says, let's turn our attention to variables. If in this statement, pebbles have roundness, or I've been using the example of the cloth has roundness, the word roundness is regarded as a merely syncategrammatic fragment of this context, like have, or indeed, bowls, or ness. If that's true, then the truth of one doesn't entitle us to infer pebbles have something. So notice the inference that he's thinking about here. Pebbles have roundness. Can I infer from that that, therefore, there is some x such that pebbles have x? Okay, in other words, to put this in language, from pebbles have roundness to pebbles have something. Which is really just what that logical expression means, okay? So really, if you said, translate that, there is an x such that pebbles have x, or in other words, pebbles have something. Now, how is that as an argument? Pebbles have roundness, so pebbles have something. The clock is round, so the clock has roundness, so the clock has something. Now, some of you would like it, okay? There's a plateness sitting right over there. Love it, man. Love it. Yeah, pebbles have things. Clocks have things. Okay, everything has things. And I don't know why I'm making a plateness sound like that sort of tough guy from New Jersey here, but anyway, suppose you think of it, yeah. Yeah, he's from the Jersey part of Athens. So, so we've got that. Pebbles have something. And, you know, others of you are shaking your heads like, wait, what do you mean pebbles have something? If I said, hey, I have some pebbles, but do the pebbles have anything? You'd say, what do you mean, do the pebbles have anything? Right? It'd be very odd to say, of course they do, they have roundness. That feels like some weird philosophy joke. And so Quine is sort of saying, yeah, you know, if you've drunk from the plateness Kool-Aid, you might like pebbles have something. In fact, you might think, actually, pebbles have roundness is the way to explain the fact that pebbles are round. What is it for something to be round? It's for it to have roundness. And so pebbles are round by virtue of the fact that they have roundness. This is really the revealing deep explanation. But if you're not somebody who's drunk plateness Kool-Aid, you might say, that there's something weird. It just sounds weird, right? It sounds different. In fact, I'd rather say pebbles are something, namely round, than to say they have something like roundness. And so if you have that instinct, and that's Quine's instinct. He thinks there's something strange that's gone on here. So he says, look, what where have is understood in the context is have roundness, and roundness is understood syncategrammatically. The use of the variable x after have in pebbles have an x such that, well, there is an x such that pebbles have x, or in other words, pebbles have something, would be as ungrammatical as saying, you know, there is an x such that peb x has roundness. And so there's something that seems odd about this to him. Well, now why? Here we get a serious argument. And this is something I think worth taking very seriously and thinking about hard. He says variables are pronouns. So what is a variable like this doing in a logical notation? Or something like a thing, maybe, in something? The idea is this. It's really acting as a kind of pronoun. And so although Quine says here in the end, to be is to be a value of a variable, a way to put that in more ordinary language terms is that to be is to be the kind of thing a pronoun can stand. Variables are like pronouns in logic. And so what do we use pronouns for? Well, they stand in for nouns. And so you might think, actually, that's a dumb way of thinking about it. Just focus on the nouns. Think focus on the proper names, for example. But Quine's worried about that because he knows you can introduce proper names for things that don't exist. And so he says, yeah, look, Pegasus, I don't want to be committed to Pegasus's existence, even if I use the term Pegasus. And so I know it's possible to name things that aren't there and have proper names in my language that denote nothing. So it's not wise to focus on names, but pronouns, that's something else. So he says, really, variables are pronouns. And now we can think pronouns are really ultimately the thing that reveals what we're talking about. The kind of thing we can refer to as, oh, that, it, those, them, etc. Those are the things that we're actually committed to talking about. Yeah?
What would Russell's response be to this?
I think Quine thinks of himself here as in part giving you the moral of Quine's, of Russell's treatment of descriptions. And so overall, I think Russell would like this idea. He doesn't quite put it in this way himself, but if you start thinking, well, gosh, the present king of France is bald, does that involve some commitment to something? Yeah, it does involve a commitment to the king of France, to there being a present king of France. And if you wrote it out in logical terms, it would indeed be this, there is an X, such that X is king of France. That would be the thing that causes the trouble.
So this works well with...
I think it works really well with Russell. Okay. And Quine is designing it for that. He, in part, has Russell in mind. He's giving us a way of seeing how what really matters here. And so don't think it's a proper name. Among the things over here I should have written down are things like definite descriptions. And, you know, Russell would be saying, yeah, I thought the moral of my story is don't focus on this, don't focus on this. And in the end, although he doesn't draw the consequence, Quine says, think about the moral of that story. In the end, it's the variable that's doing the work in us. It's the X of there is an X. Okay, so we can reach this in other ways. And we can do it by thinking about a logical notation and how it functions. So he says, it appears suitable to describe names simply as those constant expressions which replace variables and are replaced by variables according to the usual laws of quantification. What are those laws of quantification? What are the laws that govern things like this, there is an X? At this point, I think we can get rid of our categorematics and categorematic distinction. So let me erase this and think about the way that those items function in logic. Okay, so we need something like the existential quantifier. What does it do in logic? The existential quantifier functions like that, and it goes in front of some formula in the logic, and typically, let's say, you might have a logical notation that requires this, or it might just be the standard usage of it, that has some free variable x. I could tell you officially what a free variable is and a bound variable and so on, but I'm not going to. Okay, it's easy to pick up in context, so let's ignore some of the fine points. And just think about how this functions. What characterizes it? We might think of it in terms of rules, and think about what logical rules are involved in understanding this quantifier. We also might think in terms of what it means, how we understand its meaning in a logical theory. So let's first of all think about rules. What rules typically go along with the existential quantifier? Well, in thinking about logical rules, there are two kinds. We can think about what it takes to introduce such a thing into the language, or I should say, what it takes to infer that from some premise, and then what it takes to actually infer something from it. So these are usually referred to as introduction and elimination. So let's think about existential quantifier introduction, existential quantifier elimination. What does it take to introduce something like there is an X such that A of X? In other words, something like there is an X such that pebbles have X. We've actually got a perfect example of it right here.
A of X.
Yeah, we have A of, well now, We could formulate the rule, and many people do, so it's just A of X. Or we could say, well, really, it's like having a name, right? Pebbles have roundness, or I have something in my hand, right? This piece of chalk. So you might say, I have a piece of chalk in my hand, so I have something in my hand. I have this in my hand, I have something in my hand. So in short, there's some constant here. I will write A instead of X here, because usually we would set things up so that this is really a name of something, a constant term, rather than a variable. So think of A as something like a constant. The X is the variable. So if I've got something true of this, it's true of something. I am standing in front of the classroom. Therefore, something is standing in front of the classroom. Now, existential elimination, that's a lot harder. And actually, many people have different rules for this. Quine has his own favorite, which is, in my opinion, by far the best. So I'll just go with Quine's way of thinking about it. Suppose we have, there is an X such that A of X. What could we infer from that? You might say, I have something in my hand. What is it? Treat you like your kindergartners. I have something in my hand. What can you infer from that?
It's not nothing.
Well, it's not nothing. That's true. That's true. If I said, I've got something in my hand, namely nothing. Oh, he's a Heideggerian. That's okay. Yeah, I see it. Well, a handful of you.
A handful of you think that's funny.
Oh, I'm about to roll. Okay. Yeah. Quine's way of thinking about it is to say, look, you've got something in your, I've got something in my hand, and let's say we want to talk about it. And so I might do that by using a pronoun, right? By just using the variable. I'd say, so what do you think? Is it white? Is it round? Does it have roundness? I can ask you all these questions about it. But suppose I don't want to use a pronoun. I don't like the idea of just using this variable. I want to introduce a name for it, okay? As I might in mathematics, I might say, for example, in proving the mean value theorem. So there is some point in that interval at which blah, 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 the point is something has a property. And typically what I do then is what? I introduce some name for that point. I say, so there is some number n such that blah, 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 right? Or suppose I've discovered that someone in the organization is leaking secrets. We don't know who yet. I could just keep talking about the person who is leaking secrets or something else, but that's kind of difficult. I could just use pronouns saying he or she, if we don't know who it is. But what else could I do?
You can give them a new name that's not used before.
Exactly, give them a new name. So I could say, yeah, let's call the leaker. Gosh, what? Deep throat has been taken, so we'll call it what? Deep shoe. Something like that. And then we can talk about deep shoe and give, in effect, this person a name. So we can do the same thing here. There is some object that has this property A. Well, let's call that object something. And so we introduce a constant. Now, notice this is a constant, but actually it's very important that it be a new constant. If I say, yes, the person who's been leaking these secrets, let's call him Bob, as I look straight, Bob, right? That's no good. I've got to introduce some name that doesn't presuppose anything. My daughter, by the way, has a tendency to do this. She won't know people's names, but she gets tired of talking to, or talking about the person fitting a certain description and so on, so she just introduces a name for that person. And this isn't always wise, because then you get to know the person and you're constantly tempted to call them by that name. Over the weekend, she, yes, there's this organist that who's recently been hired. And anyway, she was talking to, as it happened, the organist's wife, saying, oh yeah, the new organist, Billy. And wait, I'm married to him. His name is not Billy, it's David. Okay? Or she did that with various cats in my neighborhood. So there's one cat I thought had, you know, was named Figaro or something. And then I walk down to the circle and actually meet the owner of the cat. I say, oh, Figaro is such a nice cat. That cat's name is Tom or whatever. I was like, oh. That's when I found out my daughter just produces all these names that I had thought for all these years. She actually knew the names of these people and objects instead of just making them up. Anyway, this is what she did. She was just making up new constants, and so practicing good Quinean logic. Now, it's very important that you not stop there, right? That the conclusion you're ultimately aiming at in doing a proof using this rule does not include this name. Otherwise, you know, you can get to conclusions like the new organist's name is Billy, and you end up in a silly place. Yes?
I know we don't have much time left, but I like really am struggling to see how this helps us.
How does this help us?
Talk about what there really is.
Good. Good, good, good. This is all just the way of introducing it and what we mean by the rules. But now we can talk about the semantics. So we can say, how do we interpret these darn things anyway? Now, Quine is making two points here. One is that what we, it's not that we start with the idea of a name here and then really use this, although it looks that way in the logic. He wants to say, I understand by a constant the kind of thing that will let me infer this, or that I can infer from something like this. So a constant is the kind of thing that, in other words, I've got the something, I'm convinced of the something, and then I'm allowed to use a name for the thing in the logic. So I'm not allowed to actually use names that don't denote anything in this logical language. And the semantics of this is important to understand. A model is going to consist of a domain of objects. And what's the idea? These constants stand for particular objects in the domain. So here is, you might say, intuitively speaking, that object, A, the thing that the constant A stands for. The variables will range over the things in this domain. They can stand for various things in that domain. And then the objects in this domain will have some properties, and they will stand in relations, and we will understand the property in terms of the sets of objects having the property, and the relations in terms of n tuples of objects standing in the relation. But in the end, it's really the objects in this domain that all of this is about. And so a logic characterized in these ways, where we've got quantifiers like this, where they range over, now, objects, individuals in the domain. This is all known as first-order logic. And what Quine is basically saying is that first-order logic is the canonical language of science. In the end, what we need here are the symbolic things, mathematics, functions, variables, and so on. And in short, we need first-order logic. What is that logic like? It's a logic that allows us to talk about, to quantify over a set of objects, to understand them as having properties and relations, and so as giving us a sort of Aristotelian picture of the universe. Now, what is it going to be? Well, it's just to be one of those things in the domain, to be among the things the variables range over. Hence, to be, well, to be one of those things, to be a value of a variable, which is another way of saying to be in that domain. Now, from one point of view, you could say, I've learned nothing. What is it to be? It's to be among the things that we're talking about. And it's like, gosh, you could have said that without all this logic. But next time, as we'll see, he thinks he's gotten something, because by the end, he says, well, there are things we talk about, but then we have some way of transforming that into something else. And in short, it becomes clear that the underlying picture really is this, and that what we're doing is identifying the spots we have to worry about, and then he gives us a method of trying to structure that domain. More on that next time.